Turn in your Bibles, if you would, to Colossians chapter 2. And in Colossians chapter 2, on the subject of our being complete in Christ as believers, we trust the gospel, in whom you also trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that you believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. God, the Holy Spirit, baptizes the believer into the Lord Jesus Christ, and we're identified with the Lord Jesus Christ in his death, burial, and resurrection. By one Spirit are we all baptized into one body. And Colossians chapter 2 mentions in verse 10 that we're complete in Christ, which is the head of all principality and power. Verse 11, in whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, and putting off of the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God. So that's the baptism that identifies us with Christ. It's the operation of God, who hath raised him from the dead, and you, being dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. The identification that we have with the Lord Jesus Christ is how God took care of the problem of our sin. God's redemptive plan was through the Lord Jesus Christ, the seed of the woman. He would reverse the effect of sin passing upon all men, and the death that spiritual, physical, and the soulish death of the believer that happens because of sin. So, it's the death of all men. We're born with a sin nature, and then by faith in the gospel, God the Holy Spirit identifies us with Christ, and we're quickened, we're made alive by being identified together with the Lord Jesus Christ. That identification with Christ is how when Christ was crucified, we're crucified together with him. When Christ was buried, we're buried together with him. When Christ was raised, we're raised together with him. That's how God's plan of redemption was accomplished, and it was through the cross work of the Lord Jesus Christ. And God, according to the Apostle Paul, when God gave the law to the nation of Israel in time past, he gave it to the nation of Israel until the seed would come. Go ahead and turn to Galatians 3. And in Galatians 3, the Apostle Paul says in verse 18, wherefore then serveth the law? It was added because of transgressions, till the seed should come, to whom the promise was made, and it was ordained by angels in the hand of a mediator. Now, a mediator is not a mediator of one, but God is one. Is the law then against the promises of God? God forbid, for if there had been a law given which should have given life, verily righteousness should have been by the law. But the Scripture hath concluded by the law, all under sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. For before faith came, the Lord Jesus Christ, we were kept under the law, shut up unto the faith which should afterwards be revealed. Wherefore the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith. And if you read down verse 25, he connects this with the promise, again, that he's made here in the passage. He's referring to the promise made to Abraham of eternal life in the land of as an everlasting possession. And that was made possible through the crosswork of the Lord Jesus Christ. The new covenant it had to do with the Lord Jesus Christ going to the cross, paying for sin, and that God foreseeing that he would identify all believers with his son, and it's by Christ's death, burial, and resurrection that the sins are taken care of for all men, all believers who've trusted the message that God required for salvation throughout the ages. So he says in verse 26, "For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus," talking about our being identified together with him by faith in the gospel. Verse 29, "And if ye be Christ's, then are ye Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise." Now that promise isn't every promise God made to Abraham for his seed. Because you have the prophetic program that has to do, and I keep wanting to point to the chart when I talk about these things in time past, but we've taken it down to put some things on the board today. But the promises that God made to Abraham as the Israel's father, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are Israel's fathers. Those promises that of his seed he would make a great nation, physical seed, and that that seed was given a promise. God made Abraham a land promise, gave Abraham the boundaries of that inheritance. It covers almost all the area around the Mediterranean Sea and eastward for a couple hundred miles. And so it covers a huge area that Israel never occupied, even under Solomon's reign. Israel never occupied the entire land inheritance that God promised to Abraham and his seed. And that is going to be realized at the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, because it's the Lord Jesus Christ who's going to subdue all the Israel's enemies. He's going to put down all rebellion against God. He's going to sit on a throne in Jerusalem, on the throne of David, and it's through the Lord Jesus Christ that Israel inherits all the promises, both the physical promises made to Abraham and the spiritual promises. We, as members of the body of Christ, we receive all the spiritual promises of eternal life, the hope of a resurrection body, having our sins forgiven, all those spiritual promises made to Israel that were promised in as part of the new covenant. It wasn't the law that was to take care of Israel's sin problem and make Israel righteous and give Israel eternal life and make Israel able to inherit the promises God made to Abraham. It was the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ and being identified together with him that make that possible. And so we read down in the passage here that the circumcision is how God deals with our sin problem in Christ. And yet circumcision through in the scriptures relates, as we've studied last week and a little bit the week before, it has to do with faith. It has to do with the heart. And the true circumcision that God's word reveals to us has to do with the circumcision made without hands, the issue of God cutting the flesh away from the heart. The heart being able, go with me to Deuteronomy chapter 30. The heart being able to trust in God without wavering. The real issue, how is it that when God promised that Israel would inherit the land as an everlasting possession, and yet being promising that to Abraham, and then he tells Abraham, but you're going to die 400 years later, Israel's going to come out of Egypt, and then they're going to be born as a nation and so forth. When God delivered them from Egyptian bondage, Israel becomes a nation. But Abraham is still promised to inherit this land, but he tells them, you're going to die before you inherit it. So the inheritance is going to have, Abraham's going to inherit it in resurrection life. Abraham believes God when God promises him to give him an heir at 99 years old. So circumcision had a little bit to do with Abraham not trusting his flesh to have an heir. But God was going to make that promise happen with his spiritual power, and he waited until Abraham and Sarah were well old past childbearing years in order to show them that life, eternal life, is from God. God is the one who gives life, imparted life to Adam when he formed him out of the dust. Life is, God is the source of all life, with the plagues that God used Moses, gave those miracles to Moses to demonstrate to Pharaoh that he is the true God. Most of those were God making life out of nothing, and the Egyptian magicians those that tried to match the miracles that Moses performed, throwing down the rod, their rods became snakes. But remember, the rod that Aaron threw down was able to eat the serpents of the Egyptian magicians and sorcerers. And so God demonstrated with all those miracles in Egypt that he is the one who can make life out of nothing. They couldn't make all the locusts. They couldn't make the flies. They couldn't make the frogs. They couldn't do all those things because they didn't have the power to make or to give life. And so God is, throughout the scriptures, is the only source of life. Satan can poses as God over there with the miracles in the book of Revelation, and he's going to have the power to call fire down. God's going to give him that power during the tribulation period. But Satan does not have the power to give life. The Antichrist is going to be, he's going to die of a mortal wound. He's going to be raised up. That's a lying sign and wonder that God allows him to have to deceive those that would not believe God anyway. And that's a time of judgment. Special things are happening during that tribulation period. But Satan never could give life. God is the only God with that that has the power to give life. Back here in Deuteronomy chapter 30, when God gave the law to Moses, this is the second giving of the law. Moses tells the nation of Israel, God reveals through Moses to Israel, I'm making this covenant with you, this law covenant, and if you keep it, I'm going to bless you above all nations. But you're not going to be able to do it, and so as a result, you're going to receive the curses that come from disobeying me and going after other gods instead of worshiping me, and as a result of that, you're going to be carried out of the land that I promised you. But there will become a day when all the blessings and curses come upon you. He says in verse 1, and it shall come to pass that when all these things are come upon thee, the blessing and the curse, which I have set before thee, and thou shalt have called thee to mind among all the nations whither the Lord thy God hath driven thee, and shalt return unto the Lord thy God, and shalt obey his voice according to all that I command thee this day, thou and thy children with all thine heart and with all thy soul. So God commanded Israel under the law to follow him with all their heart and with all their soul. Now, the mind of the soul is in the Bible is described as a heart. That's the seat where where our soul makes a decision between walking in the flesh and walking in the spirit as believers. The mind of our soul makes decisions. It can choose to believe God and follow him as a believer, or follow after the lusts of our flesh. So the soul is where our ego, who we are, our identity is found in our soul. And we, again, choose between faith and walking in unbelief with our soul. Well, their soul would follow God, love God, and with part of their soul they would follow him, but then they would go back the other way and they would turn against God and disobey him. So God's going to make them so that their heart, mind, and soul can love them. And look at the way that God describes that work that he's going to do upon them in verse 6. And the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart and the heart of thy seed to love the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul, that thou mayest what? Live. God is going to give them eternal life. God is going to make them righteous. God is going to identify them we find through progressive revelation after the cross, through Paul it's revealed, and through Hebrews and other passages in the New Testament, the Lord reveals revelation in the Gospels, and especially John 17, that there's under the new covenant, after the cross, God is, by identification with Him, going to make all believers righteous, and He has a purpose concerning the prophetic program with Abraham and his seed. There's through the redemptive work of the cross and with the church, the body of Christ, God's redemptive plan to make us righteous by identifying us together with the Lord Jesus Christ. We're made righteous in Christ. For He hath made Him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we may be made the righteousness of God in Him. So life is going to come through the new covenant. Life comes through the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. God reveals that progressively after the cross, but God promises here to circumcise the believers' hearts in Israel under the new covenant. So this issue of circumcising their heart, the issue of faith, the issue of God giving Israel, go now with me if you would. Well, look at verse 10. Let's read down this passage. If thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to keep His commandments and His statutes which are written in the book of the law, and if thou turn unto the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul. So the issue is the heart is described as having faith in God, and to devote your faith toward Him and believe in Him and exercise your heart to respond to God's Word, to allow God's Word to, it's for doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction, and righteousness. When you yield your heart, when you allow your soul to be exposed to the Word of God and you believe it, it effectually worketh in you that believe. It effectually worked in believers in time past when they believed it. So there's the issue of God the Holy Spirit using the spiritual words of this book upon those in time past when they believed the Word of God, and there's the issue of that working upon us too today as believers. The Word of God is a spiritual book. God the Holy Spirit uses that book, and when we place our faith in it, it has power. It had power in time past. If they turned to the Lord with their heart of faith, that they would be saved, and God would keep them. God knoweth those which are His. Romans chapter 3 talks about Christ was made propitiation, 325, for the sins that are past, having to do with the saints in time past, and for us today who trust in Christ, He's just and justifier of those which believe. But He says in verse 12 of chapter 30, It is not in heaven that thou shouldest say, who shall go up for us to heaven and bring down unto us that we may hear it and do it. Verse 14, but the word is very nigh unto thee, in thy mouth, notice, and in thy heart, that thou mayest do it. So the heart of faith takes in the Word of God. The Word of God is demonstrated as that. And by the way, when we talk about the heart of a believer, to love the Lord thy God, it's not the fleshly emotional love that the Word of God's talking about. It's to value and esteem the things that God says, and to love and value, put the value and worth on what God says, to believe it, to trust in it, to believe what, that's the love that He's talking about, to value God and to value His Word and to love Him in that way. Look at verse 15. See, I've set before thee this day life and good and death and evil, in that I command thee this day to love the Lord thy God, to walk in His ways and to keep His commandments and His statutes and His judgments, that thou mayest live and multiply, and the Lord thy God shall bless thee in the land whither thou goest to possess it. But if thine heart turn away, so that thou wilt not hear, see the issue of faith, that thou wilt not hear, but shall be drawn away and worship other gods and serve them, I denounce unto you this day that ye shall surely perish, and that ye shall not prolong your days upon the land whither thou goest over Jordan to possess it. And look at verse 20. that thou mayest love the Lord thy God, and that thou mayest obey his voice, and thou mayest cleave unto him, for he is thy life and the length of thy days, that thou mayest dwell in the land which the Lord swear unto thy fathers, to Abram, and to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give them. So, as Moses gives the law, he refers back to the promise. And the promise is going to be made possible by them trusting in God after they fail under the law, because they're not going to be able to keep the law because they had a sin nature, just like we have a sin nature, and the law just manifests sin, and that's the purpose in the law, to bring them to Christ, show them that they're sinners, they need to trust in God. Now go to 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and look at verse 3. For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshy tables of the heart. See the issue with the heart here? Notice the issue with the New Testament that he makes reference to here is the issue of the circumcision of the heart, that is the Colossians chapter 2, the issue of being identified with Christ, the issue of faith, the issue of God the Holy Spirit, all the issues that the promise of the new covenant were to give to the nation of Israel. Look at verse 4. And such trust we have through Christ to God, we're not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think of anything of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God, who hath made us able ministers of the New Testament. So we're ministers of the New Testament. Okay, believers, members of the body of Christ, are ministers of the New Testament. Now he explains what he means. Not talking about the New Testament that God, with all the land promises and the physical promises God had made to the nation of Israel under the New Covenant, but he is talking about the spiritual blessings, as he goes on to say, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. We're not under the letter of the law. So he contrasts the Old Testament with the New Testament. So, you know, I know some people say, well, you know, there's a difference between the covenant and the testament. And the testament requires the debt, somebody to die, in order for that contract to be go into force. Because Christ, it wasn't until after the death of Christ, the testator, that the new covenant blessings are passed on to the nation of Israel. And that's true, but what about the Old Testament? Who died that made that testament in effect? And so it was an animal, wasn't it? When Moses was entered, God commanded Moses to make animal sacrifices, and Moses used the blood to spatter upon the testament of the law and upon the people. So the animal's death was the testator, and that ratified that covenant. And so the issue, my point is, there's no difference between the new covenant and the New Testament, because there are different ways of describing the same thing. But with the Lord Jesus Christ, yes, it did not go into effect until the cross, because it's the blood of Calvary that ratified the new covenant. And so those animal sacrifices that ratified the Old Testament, they were looking forward to the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, weren't they? All those animal sacrifices were types and shadows of the true blood that would be shed on the cross of Calvary. But if we read down, I want you to see what Paul says, we're ministers of the New Testament. He says, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. So this is a testament of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit, small s, Spirit, giveth life. But if the ministration of death, written and graven in stones, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, his face shone, they couldn't look at it, he'd put a covering on his face so they could, they wouldn't be freaked out when they saw him after he was on the top of the mountain with God for so many days, Sinai. Verse 8, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit, notice, there's the ministration of the Spirit and there's the ministration of death. Which is it that Paul says we're under? Says verse 8, How shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of the condemnation, that's the law, be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness, that's the New Testament, exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect by reason of the glory that excelleth. For if that which was done away was glorious, what was done away? The law. Much more, that which remaineth is glorious. What remaineth? That's the New Testament. So after the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ was shed, the new covenant is in effect. And according to Hebrews, what did away with the old covenant was the new covenant. The new covenant is in effect for us, and the new covenant that was the blood of Christ that was that paid the IOUs in the Old Testament of all that God allowed to have eternal life that died in faith and went to Abraham's bosom or went to the heart of the earth, and they were kept on the side of hell that was safe for them. It was the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ that kept them safe, but it wasn't until after the cross that God revealed to the principalities and powers how he was just and the justifier of them which believed in time past and today, and how it's right. And because Christ didn't just sweep sins under the rug in time past, God didn't sweep them under the rug. He had a plan to pay for each one of them at the cross. And God is the God who cannot lie. He promised it, and he fulfilled it, and he knew he would. But anyway, that which is done away by the cross, the New Testament. Go to Jeremiah chapter 31. So the New Testament, Paul says, we're ministers of. There was a connection there with not being in tables of stone, but in the fleshy tables of the heart. And Jeremiah 31 and verse 33. Behold, the days come, verse 31, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, the old covenant, which my covenant they break, although I was an husband unto them, saith the Lord. Notice verse 33. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and shall be their God, and they shall be my people. So notice it's the effect that the new covenant is going to have on their hearts. Go with me to Romans chapter 4, verse 11. And Abraham received the sign of circumcision. What did it represent? A seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had being yet uncircumcised, that he might be the father of who? All them that believe, though they be not circumcised, that righteousness might be imputed on them also, and the father of circumcision to them who are not of the circumcision only, but who also walk in the steps of the faith of our father, of that faith of our father Abraham, which he had being yet uncircumcised. So they walked in faith, and he's the father of them that were under the physical sign of circumcision. And what was the sign of circumcision given to them for? It was a sign or a seal of the righteousness of the faith which Abraham had being uncircumcised, that he might be the father of all them that believe. So it's a sign of faith. Go to Romans chapter 2 and look at verse 28. For he is not a Jew which is one outwardly, neither is that circumcision which is outward in the flesh, but he is a Jew which is one inwardly, and the circumcision, and circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of God. The issue is faith, God seeing the faith of Abraham, God imputing it to that person for righteousness. The issue with Israel has always been the issue of faith, and having the faith of Abraham, which he had being uncircumcised, and circumcision was a seal of the faith that Abraham had being uncircumcised. And that was he was the type of all those after him who had received the promise of eternal life from God, and the issue was of the heart and not the circumcision that was of hands. The circumcision which was of hands was just symbolic of the righteousness of faith that Abraham had being uncircumcised. And that's all we have time for today. We'll pick up here next time.